Well, howdy, y'all. This is Erin Kimbrough with Texas AgriAbility and the Battleground to Breaking Ground project. Just wanted to say thanks for joining us and thanks for taking the time out of your day to watch the Farmers Market webinar. We're really excited and blessed to have some special guests here with us today. Ms. Jules and Ms. Flora Williams are with our Family and Community Health Department, and they do lots of neat things with us, like our cottage food law, food handlers courses, and they also do some education around selling at a farmer's market.
All right. So like she said, this is a presentation on Texas farmers markets and becoming a vendor. Yay. So the learning objectives in this particular presentation, we're going to talk, like I said, about the farmer's market law, and this is under the state rules, so when you start talking about local jurisdictions, they can be a little bit more strict once again. We're going to list some foods that can and cannot be sold at a farmer's market, recognize common items that are sold at a farmer's market, and some of the requirements for selling each of them, because depending on what they are, there's going to be different requirements. Which one you might need a permit or not. We're going to discuss a little bit of basic food safety practices that's actually required depending on the type of permit you have at a farmer's market. And then review some tips and materials needed for a successful booth at a farmer's market. So the farmer's market rules, like it states on the slide, is that the farmer's market regulations for Texas apply to farmer's markets everywhere except in counties that have a population of less than 50,000 and have no local health department. So if you're in an area, like it says here, the farmers market in these areas must follow Texas food establishment rules. So everybody else is going to follow the farmers market rules, but if you have less than 50,000 and no local health department, then you're going to follow the Texas food establishment rules. Some common items that are sold at a farmer's market would be whole, uncut produce, your meat products and fish products, canned tomatoes, your relishes, your salsas, your pickled squash, anything you're canning, honey, eggs, baked items. You can sell wine and beer at farmer's markets now, non-food items, and you can also sell live animals. So we're going to cover some more requirements for each of those in the following slides. So selling produce. You can sell whole, intact, unprocessed fruits and vegetables and not required to have a permit. So if you're selling a whole watermelon, no problem, no permit. So if you start cutting your produce, that's when you're going to start needing a permit. Same thing if you're selling cut tomatoes, cut leafy greens, or cut melons. You'll have to get a permit, and then you'll have to keep your food at 41 degrees or below. And the permit we're talking about is actually a temporary food establishment permit.
Where do they get the permit from?
So depending on their jurisdiction, it would either be your local health department or the state.
Oh, great. Okay. That's helpful. Just so you know, that for some reason, what they're seeing is this screen.
Oh.
Not that one.
Oh.
But I don't know how to make that. I just... It looks right to me, so I don't know. I don't know how.
Where are you going? So if you're going to sell meats can be sold where, like it says here, that are slaughtered at a licensed facility, and if the vendor has proper permitting and proper labeling. So proper packaging labeling, that's important when you're selling the meat. Labels should contain a mark of inspection. It's either going to have DSHS or the USDA. And then you're going to have your name and address of the facility where you had it processed, the ingredients, any safe handling instructions, and warning labels that says keep refrigerated or frozen, as well as the net weight statement. So if this product does not contain this information, it shouldn't be sold. Do not sell products that are labeled not for sale. So if this information is not provided, do not sell the product. More on selling meat. So there is an exemption for small poultry and rabbit. Poultry and rabbit can be sold if you're a vendor and you slaughter less than 10,000 poultry, rabbits, or a combination of both each year. You still have to get the obtain the proper permits and have proper labels on the products. This is a in case for this custom exemption is for very low volume, like it was saying. The vendor has to obtain either a temporary food establishment permit or a farmer's market permit, depending on the jurisdiction. And once again, just like the other meats, it has to have the label correctly on there, and it says that it's an exempted statement for this particular one. So if you're selling meats like exotic meats, exotic animals can be sold that were slaughtered, once again, at a licensed facility, and if the vendor has a temporary food establishment permit or a farmer's market permit, once again, depending on your jurisdiction, and contains a proper label. Like it says in the slide, hunter-harvested swine, exotics, bison, etc. are not eligible for sale. What they consider exotic animals would be a member of a species of game not indigenous to this state, including axis deer, nagal, antelope, or other cloven-hoofed ruminant animals. Some other ones also include, but are not limited to, sika, antelope, elk, camels, and llamas.
So that does not include things like wild duck?
No, that those won't be considered exotic because they are local to the state.
Yes, okay.
If you're going to sell fish, it can be sold if you have a licensed commercial fisherman that possesses a license from either the Texas Park and Wildlife Department or the Texas Department of Ag, and once again have a proper permit from your regulatory authority. So also including the fish is produced and raised in a facility that has an aquatic or aquaculture license from the Texas Department of Ag, you could do that as well. So selling canned products, we kind of touched on that, I think, when we did the cottage food, but you can also sell it at a farmer's market. At the farmer's market, you can sell a little bit more. Like it says here, canned salsas, tomatoes, pickled squash, etc., they can be sold if they have a manufacturer's license for the products being sold and or a retail food permit. So like it says here, if you're required to complete the Better Process Control School, I know the Horticulture Department tries to do it every October, every year, and that's the only time it's offered in Texas. And that is a requirement if you're going to sell the other types of foods like canned, like it says up there, the canned salsas and that type of canned goods. So selling honey, this is actually relatively new too. So they've divided it into small scale and large scale production. So if you've got small scale production honey, that's if you produce less than 2,500 pounds of honey per year. You sell the honey or the honeycomb that you produce yourself, and you're selling it to the end consumer. And you can bottle it in a non-inspected facility, but you're going to have to put a label on there saying that it's being bottled in such a facility. Like it says here, the label includes your net weight, the beekeeper's name and address, and the statement that it's not bottled in a facility inspected by the Texas Department of Health Services. That's for your small scale. So if you've got a large scale production, vendors can sell honey if it's packed and properly labeled by an entity that has a food manufacturer's license and is extracted and bottled in a compliant kitchen. So pretty much an inspected kitchen. It's going to be a retail kitchen that you're bottling from. And then once again, like it says here, you have to follow the labeling because of the FDA rules and regs. So selling eggs at the farmer's market, they can be sold, but you have to obtain a temporary food establishment permit from DSHS or the local regulatory authority. Multiple permits might be required if you're traveling to other counties to sell your eggs. So if you've got local jurisdictions all around you, you're probably going to sit there and pay and have to get permits for all those counties. And if you go into a state one, you're getting the state permit as well. So that can get costly and time-consuming trying to fill out all that paperwork. You want to make sure you're keeping your eggs at an ambient air temperature of 45 degrees Fahrenheit or below. And then with labeling, eggs are labeled as ungraded with safe handling instructions as well as the producer's vendor's name and address. And you don't want to use used egg cartons. They do require that you're purchasing new ones and that you're putting your label on there. You can't, use the ones from the store and wash them. That's not correct. You have to, they have to be not used ones. So selling baked goods, we kind of touched that on cottage foods last time we talked with cottage food. Baked goods can be sold at the farmer's market if the vendor is a cottage food production or if the vendor is selling as a nonprofit vendor. So you can sell wine or beer at the farmer's market. I think that's pretty awesome. Selling glasses or open bottles of wine or beer is permitted as long as you obtain a permit from the local TABC Commission office, and there's a website you can go to there or a phone number. And then you have to obtain a temporary food permit from the Texas Department of State Health Services or the local health authority.
And that includes if you're selling your own, like your own beer, if you're doing like microbrewery kind
of. So this is actually more on along the lines of that. I'm not sure if vendors that are not selling their own wines, if they have separate, I'm sure they have separate permits, but I don't know if it's the same as this one.
Okay.
So this is the one that, yeah, if you're selling your own wine or beer is what we're talking about with this particular side.
Awesome.
So mobile food vendors are allowed to come to the farmers markets and sell as well. It kind of helps, you know, generate business and people to come and see the neat things. So an individual or company can sell food via mobile food unit, as long as they are properly licensed. Same thing, temporary food permit is not necessary if you already have a mobile food permit, so you're actually a retail food establishment, just on wheels.
Can you, if you only sell at the farmer's market, so let's say you're not a mobile vendor, you might be getting to it, but if you're like cooking cheeseburgers for the farmer's market and you have like a, kind of like a booth, Does that count under?
So you're not selling your own product?
I guess you could. So if I'm a grass-fed beef producer and I want to sell cheeseburgers, so...
As a meal.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think that's allowed as a vendor. You can do sampling.
Okay.
But you wouldn't be able to sell a full-on meal. You can sample free.
Okay.
But you can't sell, like, a meal. Like,
if
you did that, you would have to start getting all the other permits and stuff as a retail food establishment or a mobile food vendor.
Okay, so you'd have to be a mobile food vendor and actually sell the food.
Right.
Okay, that's fine. Because I know they've done that since, like, schools and stuff, like, where they set up tables and sold food. But
yeah.
I don't know how they did that.
So, yeah, it depends if it's nonprofits, how they can do that, what the particular place is trying to sell and make money for, if they're making money for a nonprofit or...
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure there's going to be different rules and different permits and regs for that.
Okay, is that the health department who knows those permits?
Yes.
Okay.
So, of course, at farmers markets, everybody's probably seen that you can sell non-food items. And non-food items can be sold if an entity operating or regulating the farmers market allows it. So different farmers markets might have different rules. Some may just say, all we're selling is produce or food. Some will say, hey, yeah, come on, if you're making your own soaps, knitted scarves, crafts, your jewelry, your flowers, lotions, and soaps, then a lot of them do sell that these days, but there are still a few I think I've seen where they only want you selling food. So you can sell live animals. Live animals can be sold if the entity operating or regulating the farmers market allows for such vendors, as once again, they have to obtain proper approval or permits with one or more of the listed agencies, so with the Texas Animal Health Commission, the Texas Department of State Health Services, the Zoonosis Program, and the Texas Parks and Wildlife, just depending on what you're selling. So what cannot be sold at farmers markets? Raw milk products. Raw milk is milk from cows, goats, sheep, or other animals that has not been pasteurized. And the reason for that is because the raw milk and the raw milk products can contain harmful germs, like bacteria, viruses, and parasites, which can make you sick. And so if they're not pasteurized, it could make you ill, like it said there. So that's one reason they don't allow it at a farmer's market. So cooking demonstrations are allowed at farmer's markets. They have to be conducted under the supervision of someone with a certified food manager certificate if you're doing cooking demonstrations. They have to follow the Texas Food Establishment rules, and if providing samples with a cooking demonstration, it has to be for a bona fide educational purpose, and samples are disposed of within 2 hours of preparation. If you're providing samples with the cooking demonstration, like it said here, it's bona fide purpose. The cooking demonstration is made in good faith or made with earnest intent to instruct and educate. So, because people always ask, well, what is a bona fide educational purpose? If you're sitting there trying to tell them how, you know, healthy this is and how to make this particular meal because it's healthy for you and stuff, then you're educating them. So if you are sampling, it's considered a bite-sized portion, so not a full-on meal. I guess if you go back more than once to get a meal, but it's supposed to be a bite-sized portion. So to provide samples, you have to distribute them in a sanitary manner. You have to have potable water available. You have to be able to wash any produce that that's being used. You have to avoid bare hand contact. You have to clean durable surfaces to cut the foods on. And you have to keep your samples of cut produce or any potentially your TCS foods, which are time temperature control for safety foods, at 41 degrees below or 135 degrees Fahrenheit or above for hot foods. And then, like it says there, discard within 2 hours of cutting or prep. So when is a permit required? If you're going to sell time temperature control safety foods, you'll have to have a permit. If you're conducting cooking demonstrations that are not for a bona fide educational purpose, you'll have to get a permit. So no permit is actually required to sell or sample cottage foods at farmers markets. There was some question there for a while, and they finally decided this is what they're going to do with the cottage food. You can sample at farmers markets, but if a cottage food goes to another place or if they're at a fair festival that's a nonprofit one, they can't sample there. They can only sample at a farmers market for cottage food.
Now,
what about if a nonprofit owns a farmer's market? So technically the cottage food vendor is still a cottage food vendor even though they're at the farmer's market, mm-hmm. Since they're at the farmer's market, they can sample.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
But if they were at a fair or a festival that wasn't a nonprofit or even a profit, mm-hmm. they can't sample. The only place that a cottage food can sample is at a farmer's market.
Okay, so you're talking like a stock show booth.
Yeah, they wouldn't be.
Like
yeah, if you're a cottage food selling there, you technically can't sell at those types of places for a cottage food. But yeah, it gets really tricky when you're talking about cottage food and farmer's market.
So, fine line.
Yes, very fine line. So, question, will DSHS or a local health department conduct inspections at farmer's markets? Yes, they can. Because they have the authority to conduct inspections of all food vendors that are required to obtain a permit or a farmer's market permit.
Okay.
So we're going to talk a little bit about food safety. So if we want to prevent foodborne illness when you're selling or serving your foods at a farmer's market.
Yes. Can I ask a couple questions about the previous one? I didn't want to interrupt. So is on the meat, is there an example of a label that they can find of what needs to be, or like a... Because I think at the cottage food one, we had like a sample label of like the information that needs to be filled out. Is there a sample somewhere or something that tells them exactly what needs to be on the label?
I would hope. I'm not 100% sure if it's on the DSHS website.
Okay.
For some reason, we don't have it. but it would be pretty similar to the cottage food one where you just keep, as long as it's legible.
Okay.
And has the required information on there. But yeah, that's a good question. We don't have a picture of that.
Okay.
We can figure out where they might have one just so everybody knows exactly, because I don't know if it's that specific, like cottage food says this is what you have and this is what it should look like, and I don't know if there's a font requirement or anything, so I don't know, but we can find that out. Yeah.
Okay, great. So we'll see. There's a one out there for you guys maybe that we can post.
Mm-hmm.
And then they said the meat has to be at... harvested at a licensed facility. Are they specifically talking about like a USDA inspected facility
or a state one, like a DSHS one?
So if let's just for example, if I have my cattle processed at a facility and they don't have USDA inspection, they just have Texas Department of Ag inspection, is they mm-hmm. they can sell that meat at the farmer's market?
Yes, as long as it's got state inspection or federal inspection. Because it's going to have that if they go take it to a facility like that.
Yes. Well, that's new. I think that's, is that new?
I don't think so.
Oh, good. I was always under, always told that it has to be at a USDA inspected facility, which
are kind of hard to find.
So good. Oh, good. That helps a lot of people, I think. And the poultry, so you can, I can harvest poultry up to, was it 10,000? At our farm, and then as long as they're labeled correctly,
and we slaughter less than 10,000 poultry. Yeah.
Okay, and then as long as they're labeled correctly and we have a permit for the health department, we can sell that part of that poultry at the farmer's market.
Correct.
Okay, and it's a, and I think we talked about there's some temperature. We'll probably talk more about the temperature requirements on that, and the eggs are the same. So I know there was a while there was like a like I. thought, you know, some of our producers thought you had to go to like a class and all of those kinds of things to be able to sell eggs. Is that not?
No, there's not an actual class. There's a, I think, an application you have to fill out to get a permit and whatnot.
Okay.
But there's no class that you're required to go through, I don't think, that I know of.
Okay, so they don't have to be food grade or egg graders or anything like that. Okay, all right. There, I know that was a concern for some of them. Well, that's great because I think that clears up a lot of. At least for sure some misconceptions that I had about selling at a farmer's market. And it sounds like the rules that, the actual rules that apply are make it a little less difficult than I think a lot of people have perceived it to be. So removing barriers.
Fantastic.
I'm so excited.
So a little bit on food safety, your best practices, know the rules, of course. Follow good personal hygiene and proper hand washing. Avoid the cross-contamination. Make sure you're doing your temperature requirements. That's a big one, especially with your cooking demonstrations. Make sure you cook the proper internal temperatures of the foods and that you're storing and serving them safely. And, of course, cleanliness and sanitation is always good. Do not work with or around food if you're not feeling well. Do not eat or use tobacco in the food prep area. Wear a hairnet or some kind of hat. I know at the farmer's market you probably don't want to wear a hairnet, but if you wear a hat, they're usually pretty good with that being okay as a proper hair cover. Wear clean clothing. Use a barrier to prevent bare hand contact with your food. Use a glove, you know, spatula, deli tissue, or tongs. Practice proper hand washing. And so if the facility that you're at a farmer's market isn't providing you with a three-compartment sink, you'd probably have to, you're going to have to create your own. And usually a local or the state will tell you how to properly do that. And we'll actually talk about it in a later slide. Washing your hands properly, wetting the hands and forearms with warm running water, lathering up with soap and rinsing it, scrubbing between your fingers and under your nails, rinsing with the warm running water, and then drying your hands with a towel is the proper technique for washing your hands. So then don't dry it on your pants or your apron or any towels you've got around there unless it's the towel for drying your hand. I was talking about if they don't provide you one, you have to have a temporary hand washing station. It has to have soap, towels, an approved water dispenser with a spigot spout, not a push button, because you have to be able to let the water flow while you're washing your hands and not washing one hand at a time. Provide continuous flow and then provide watertight bucket or container to catch the waste because you can't just let it free flow anywhere. A little bit more, this is another type of a temporary hand wash setup that you could also do. So you're going to wash your hands before you start working with that food, before you put your gloves on, if you're going to start, you know, getting your samples ready, after you've eaten, smoked, chew gum, drink, if you're handling dirty equipment or utensils, if you moved trash cans around, if you did something with chemicals, if you had handled money because you sold a product, you're going to want to wash your hands. If you touch anything, pretty much. It's after you go use the restroom, touching your clothing. And then, like it says here, where hands must be washed in a separate sink specified for hand washing. Like we had just previously showed y'all, you could do a temporary one, but you'd have to do it the way it said it. So don't cross-contaminate. Don't transfer those germs from one food or surface to another. That would be like if you were handling some of the raw meats or eggs, and then they aren't going to be cooked further, and then you do something with them. and then not cleaning or sanitizing all your food contact surfaces before or during or in between prep. Not using separate equipment for your meats and produce. So if you cut up some meat and then you use that same cutting board to cut produce, that would be cross-contaminating. So you avoid it by keeping everything clean, wash your hands, your surfaces, avoid bare hand contact, use your cutting boards, the separate cutting boards for the separate types of foods, use clean plates and utensils, keep them separated, and then of course sealing things is the best way to help prevent that when it's in a cooler or whatnot. So you want to prevent juices from raw meat from getting into other foods. Keep them out of that temperature danger zone, which is the 135 to 41. You want, if you're cooking your samples at the farmer's market to give out, you want to cook them to the proper temperatures because that's going to kill the bacteria in the different types of foods. The only way you know that it's done is using a food thermometer. I know some people say, I know it's done because I just know, but no, you don't. You got to use a temperature, a food thermometer to know what the temperature is. Like it says here, the touch test is not acceptable, and then even color can be really deceiving. So for your poultry, your ground poultry, your stuffing with poultry, and your stuffed meats and fishes, they have to be cooked to 165 degrees. And then it has to hold it for 15 seconds, that temperature. If you're doing ground meats, ground pork, ground fish, injected meats, it's going to go to 155 for 15 seconds. Your whole cuts of meat, your fish, and your raw shellfish, raw shell eggs, is 145 for 15 seconds. And then your cooked fruits and vegetables are 135 degrees for 15 seconds. You want to make sure that if you're storing sampling food temperatures, that frozen food is kept frozen until the point of sale. So shelling ice cream needs to stay frozen. Your hot foods need to be at 135 degrees or higher, and your cold foods at 41 degrees or below. Cleaning and sanitizing, they're different. A lot of people think that's kind of intermingled, but it's not. Cleaning is the removal of your dirt and soil and grease and food off of something. Sanitizing is actually reducing the germs off of a food contact surface. Like it says here, it's not the same. You clean, then you sanitize. You don't do it the other way around. If you're sanitizing, make sure you're using test kits to make sure that it's at the proper concentration. And then if you're required, depending on the type of permit you have at a farmer's market, you might have to have a temporary three-compartment sink. And so the first basin you will have to wash. The second one, that's going to have your dish soap and stuff. The second one's going to be your rinse. You have to have clean water on that one, and then your third is going to be sanitizing. And then you want to make sure the sanitizer is at the proper concentration. Utensil washing and sanitation, household bleach, iodine, quaternary ammonium are approved sanitizers, so any of those work. Correct concentration for bleach is 50 parts per million for dishwashing. If you're doing wiping cloth, it's 100 parts per million. Correct concentration for quaternary ammonium, some people call them quats, it's 200 or 400 parts per million. You just always follow the manufacturer's rules and use your chemical test strips. Some checklists we would like to tell vendors about, because you want, like you were saying, the table was very pretty at that picture, so you want to make sure you have tables and tablecloths out there, a scale, because sometimes you're weighing things, your hand washing statement, maybe if it's a hot day because we're in Texas, you want a canopy. Bags for your products, any receipt books or pins, a calculator, price tags. Want to display your items, like it says here, under table tents, so you might need scissors, tape, that kind of stuff. Marketing item, business cards, banners, proper attire, and a big smile. And then they do have, depending on what type of permits you have, there are booth structure for temporary food establishment permits that are required, so they have to have approved flooring, and that's going to be, of course, part of the farmer's market facility having that, but you got to make sure that they have what you need if you have a certain permit. Suitable overhead covering for food prep areas, trash cans, have a way to properly dispose of grease if you've got grease disposal needed, and then cover your grills. Your booth strip, a little bit more on that, keeping the food areas clean, using approved kitchen utensils, proper storing of your eating utensils, and then use food from an approved source, of course. A little bit more tips for vendors. Ensure you have quality, unique products. Have enough of your product available. Never leave your booth unattended. Price every item. Have an adequate change available. And then educate your customers and be friendly. It's always helpful. Efficient, attractive booth layout, like we were discussing. When you have that attractive booth, people are going to want to come to your booth and check it out. Have proper signage. Abundance of your product. Try to have the most attractive booth at the market to get everybody to come to you. So some take-home messages. Understanding the farmer's market rules as it pertains to what you want to sell. Since at the farmer's market, you can sell so many things. Always practice good personal hygiene. Keep your hot foods hot, your cold foods cold. Keep your scene clean. Keep everything at the proper temperature. Limit that time in the temperature danger zone. Make sure you're storing, preparing, and serving that food safely. Make sure you have your proper permits, wherever, whatever you might be selling. These are some of the web addresses that we were discussing a little bit. So that first one is on the poultry rabbit exemption, and when you have the 10,000 or less. The second one is more questions about farmers markets in particular. The DSHS website has an FAQ there that has more information there. And then if anybody was had more questions about honeybees and selling the honey, that I put those up there in case they needed those. And that's actually it.
Wonderful. Do you have is there a slide? There you have, Julie, with your contact information. That's okay. Well, you want to go ahead and just spell it out for them real quick and your phone number, and then
sure. So
I'll share it too.
Okay. My email address is the letter JPROUSD, that's J Prouse, at TAMU.edu. And my number, my direct line, I don't have a secretary, is 979-458-2025. And if you have any questions, feel free to contact me. If I don't know the answer, I can find it out.
Wonderful. Well, I think that was a great presentation. Like I said, I'm so excited that there's so many less restrictions than I originally thought there were. So what we had discussed about like poultry is that you couldn't sell poultry that was harvested at your place off your farm unless it was USDA inspected.
So you can't sell it unless you have it processed. You can sell your chickens, but you have to have them processed at a facility.
Oh, okay. So that is
so tough. Yeah, you can't process them at your house and then sell them. It has to be processed at a facility that's inspected.
An inspected facility.
Correct.
Okay. Okay. And then help them clarify the USDA requirement so Texas Department of Ag inspection is okay.
Mm-hmm.
So that is really helpful, I think. Thinking on sampling, as I know quite a few people have products that they like to sample. So if, for example, I have, let's say I want to sell goat meat at the farmer's market, as long as we can cook it at home, is that correct? Can we cook it at home and then bring it with you as long as it's kept at the right temperature?
Depends on your permit. So it has more than likely, you have to cook the sample there,
okay,
and so you have to keep it at the temperature,
right,
135 degrees,
okay.
Yeah, for sampling.
Okay, so I'm writing this down, so I'm gonna have to wait to cook it. It's gonna do the samples at the farmer's market.
And then if you have to keep it hot, you gotta have a way to keep it warm, and then if it's something you gotta keep cold, you gotta make sure you can keep it cold as well.
Okay, wonderful. This probably goes back to the cottage foods too, is that we have a tea. We make the Yopon tea, and we want to do samples. Does that fall in these?
So tea would not. It's not considered a TCS food or a temper. It's not a potentially hazardous food.
Okay.
So there wouldn't necessarily be a permit for that one in particular. But then if you start adding ice, ice is considered a food.
Really?
Yes.
Interesting. Okay. So if it was cold already, then you can sell it as long as it doesn't have ice in it. But so if you wanted them, if they needed ice,
sell or sample.
Sample.
We
sell
the
tea leaves, but to have a sample of the tea actually already made.
So you could keep it cool if you needed beads, because like some people like to try it cold.
Mm-hmm.
You wouldn't have to necessarily put ice in it as long as if you were keeping it chilled.
Okay. And then what if you had things set out, as like if you had honey for them to sweeten their tea and different, like, usually I think we'd probably use like the little packets of sugar or whatever, but that'd be easiest. But if you wanted to have honey for them to sweeten it, is there a special requirement on
that
honey?
Oh. Honey doesn't require refrigeration.
Yay! All right. So, whew, makes that a little easier. Okay, and then if we wanted to sell it that way, say we wanted to sell tea by the glass, how does that work?
So then, depending on, I think, the jurisdiction, you might have to get a temporary food establishment permit, just depending on how you're going to serve it or sell it.
Okay. So probably the Department of Health, all of the...
Either your local one or if you're depending on your jurisdiction, because like here in Brazos County, we have a local one, so you'd want to discuss with them what they require.
Okay.
And then the state would probably require something different if you're going to a state jurisdiction.
State.
Or another local jurisdiction, for that matter.
Oh, okay. So if we were going
everybody,
to like
yeah.
a different town or something, there might
yeah.
be a different requirement.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That makes sense to me. Okay. Or are there any other questions that you guys commonly get that you think might need to be addressed as far as farmers markets go?
No, I think I answered a lot of them. Well, you have the egg questions
yes.
and the permits
Friday,
for that, the honey.
Mm-hmm. Honey is the question, I think the get the meat question.
Mm-hmm. And when you were... Julie was talking about the egg cartons. A lot of times they want to reuse egg cartons because I've had people ask us if we could collect them in our office for them.
No, I can't use them that way. Wonderful. Well, I think if you guys don't have any other things like that you think that people ask often or that you didn't get a chance to address, then I think we can go ahead and close that today. I'll go ahead and pull up our website real quick and then end on that. So if folks have any other questions, where you'll be able to find these will be on our, let's see, I'm going to share, maybe, well, hopefully sharing with you guys because we can't see it on the screen that we've got up over here. So, but you can go to our website, which is TX Agribility. It's agrability.tamu.edu. And we'll actually post this on our YouTube channel, but you can access that if you go to the Texas Agribility website. There is a little button there that says Online Courses. So if you'll just click on this Online Courses button here, you'll find this Agribility YouTube channel. And we'll also wanted to let you know, we do have a lot of events that we do some of these hands-on educational things at. I've talked to Julie and Flora about possibly partnering on doing a food handlers course. So, yes, so we need to pull that. And so we'll put that on the calendar so you guys can attend a food handlers course. How does the food handlers, having a food handlers course, does that benefit me by selling at the farmer's market? Do I need that?
Depends on the jurisdiction and are the farmer's market rules. If you're depending on the type of things you're selling, you might need a temporary food establishment permit. It might require that everybody that's there doing that must have at least a food handlers.
Okay.
And then, like I had discussed in one of those slides, an actual certified food manager is required depending on the type of food demonstrations you're doing.
Yes.
So that's even a more in-depth course that they would have to take to get a certificate for. So.
Okay. Does Extension offer the food handler managers course?
The food managers
course? Food managers
yes.
course.
Yes, or who offers it locally.
Woohoo!
I do it pretty much every other month.
Oh, wow.
I'm here.
Oh, great.
And it's a 5-year certification and it's national.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful. So if we have I think that our farmers market, we've got that the Milliken Farmers Market here. I think our the executive director of that farmers market has her food manager's course and her certificate. So if somebody like that, if your farmers market manager has their food manager's certificate, does that count?
Here locally, I think so, because I remember the one in Bryan that does in downtown.
Mm-hmm.
The one that runs that association got his, and he covered everybody that was there, but that's for Brazos County. So different counties or different jurisdictions might require something a little
bit. Have different rules. Okay, well, that's really good to know. So, folks, if you are, hop on our website, the txagribility.tagme.edu, it will, we have a newsletter on there, so I highly suggest you join that newsletter and just subscribe to it, and it's right here if you're able to see our screen, and just put your name, last name, and email address, and then we notify you about all those events that are coming up. So we're trying to do a lot of the hands-on things, and just to share with you, we had a we did a chicken processing hands-on workshop where we processed, everybody processed their own chickens. And then one of the participants at that workshop came, had to process 60 of their own chickens the next weekend. And she was able to process all of the all of her chickens, and it was and her spouse, who actually didn't attend the workshop, said it was really difficult. So it was kind of neat to have the two different, the person who had attended and the person who didn't, and for her just describe the difference that it made just attending the workshop and getting to harvest with somebody who knew what they were doing. So if you can, I highly suggest you to come out to any of those hands-on workshops. And I just want to take a second and thank Julie and thank Flora. You guys are amazing. I really appreciate you all taking the time to join us today. And we'll keep working with them on more of the farmer's market, cottage food law stuff, food handler stuff, because I know that for most of us small producers, that's a lot of places where we sell is direct to consumer. So I'm grateful for that. So thanks for taking the time, ladies. I really appreciate you.